Dirk Bogarde, in his own words. Picture Parade, broadcast on BBC Television, 10th of January, 1961.
You're one of the few English screen actors who command attention in America, command real attention, which is underwritten with real money. And I wonder what it is, over and above your capacity to act, which singles a person out for that kind of attention.
I don't know. You said international stardom. Well, I don't know what that means. I'm not an international
no,
star
No, command
yet.
Attention in America.
Oh, command attention.
With that in view, I suppose, with the
I don't really know what you mean, though, Robert, because I've only done two films in America. One they wanted me desperately for because they couldn't get anybody else.
I'm sure you're being...
Well, they wanted a special type. No, they wanted a special type of actor, which had to be an actor sort of known in Europe, the Commonwealth, for that market, and who spoke English with an English unaccented accent for Liszt, you know, because they didn't think it would be acceptable if he came from Milwaukee.
But they could have picked almost anyone for that. Yet they picked you. I think what I'm really referring to is the quality of watchableness, which allows an actor to walk into a room and read the telephone directory, and somehow it's exciting, just that. It's this quality that I'd be interested to ask you about.
I'd be awfully interested if you tell me what it was, because I know exactly what you mean. I have the same compulsion myself when I see somebody on a screen or in the theatre. I don't know why I'm looking at them very often. I suppose it's this extraordinary and ill-used and much overworked phrase, star quality, which I don't believe anybody's ever been able to define. I know that when I was in Hollywood, I was absolutely amazed to see how many of the great and lasting stars were in fact not frightfully handsome people or beautiful women, but had quite qualities of ordinariness. Now, maybe it's something to do with that quality of ordinariness, of high sophistication, if you can call it, because that means high simplicity, doesn't it, sophistication? Or have I got that quite wrong?
Well, I think it's a quality of relaxedness, perhaps.
And something to do, too, with sureness and, I suppose, sincerity.
For a film actor, you live a rather retired and private life. We seldom read of you in the show columns. Do you avoid publicity? Is it distasteful to
no,
you?
No. I don't avoid publicity. That makes it sound like something really horrid and unpleasant. I don't think publicity is always necessary. I think sometimes publicity is ugly, and I think it's vulgar, and I think then you should avoid it. And I think sometimes it's wiser perhaps to leave it all alone than to dabble with a little of it. I think that to publicise your film is absolutely splendid. You should go to a premiere if you have to. I don't like it because I don't like crowds. And you should go and talk about it to the press if they wish to see you. And you should speak to you on Picture Parade, as we're doing now. But I don't think it's of any concern to anybody but me whether I take my dogs for a walk on my head or my hat or in a basket or what I have for breakfast or how I go to bed.
You must teach some of your colleagues.
I know, but that is the trouble, because there are other people who absolutely love everybody knowing exactly what they do with their dogs and where they go for a walk and how they do it. We can't all be exactly the same. It'd be a very dull world if we were. I was always brought up, which sounds very pompous, I can't help it, to, you know, that old saying, little boys should be seen and not heard. It was very deeply drilled into me as a child, and indeed to all my brothers and sisters, and I'm afraid it kind of sticks. Now, I can't put it any better than that.
Do you think, though, that the public should... do you think there's anything against the public getting to know the actual man behind the illusion which appears on the screen?
It's a terribly tough one to answer, you know, that one, because I don't agree, anyway, and I'm quite alone on this. I think that the excitement of the cinema and the theatre is its quality of illusion, of magic, of not quite of this world. And I think that if you know that your favourite actor's bald, or that he's got spots, or he's shorter than you were, you know, the illusion's gone.
But if it's a good illusion, it wouldn't depend on you knowing about the mechanics, would you?
I think it's a great mistake to know about mechanics.
And yet you know your fellow film actors very well, and I imagine this doesn't spoil your enjoyment of the films they make.
It's a tricky one, isn't it, really? I think in a way, truly it does. Not destroy it, but I think it does harm it a little, my enjoyment of their work. I remember with Kay Kendall, who was one of my greatest and dearest friends, I was never absolutely convinced that Kate, I was never quite satisfied, which sounds conceited and impertinent, but you understand what I mean. I was never quite satisfied that Kate had done the best possible job in a film, because I knew her far too well. I knew every trick, every mood, and I was able, therefore, not always to see the work that she really was doing. So it did kind of, familiarity did kind of blunt the brilliance of her work for me a little.
You do little stage work now, and I think I read somewhere that on the last three occasions you appeared in the theatre, you became ill, and that as a consequence you decided that you do no more stage work. Is this resolution holding good?
Yes, it is. It's a great temptation. I made everybody promise faith that if I ever looked as I was moving towards the stage door, they had to shoot me. The thing about it really was that I've been off the stage for far too long, and too long a gap. I mean, to be off the stage for sort of 3 years and do, say, 12 pictures, which is what I easily have been doing, three a year, or nine pictures, whatever it is, my mathematics. It's too long a time to go suddenly straight into a play with all the intensity and the work and the necessary emotion. You're tired before you start. Then you've got to go on tour and kick the play into shape, and it's a tremendous concentration. And if you are a bit run down at the time, you know, you're liable to pick up a bug, and then you get this panic, oh, gosh, if I'm off, you know what'll happen. So it's not worth it. I must confess, too, I am appalled at the length of time a play has to run. I think this year's run, or you know, more, is absolutely appalling.
But isn't this part of an actor's, the rub of the green for an actor?
It is, but you're not talking to one of the great dedicated actors. It is indeed part of an actor's trade, but I don't think it's ever a part of an actor's trade to play one part without any break or any relief for over a year or more. I think this is absolutely insane. I think to do what Peter Hall is doing now with Stratford, switching over to the Aldrich, is terribly exciting. And the actors get a rest, they get a break in between, they can prepare the next production, and they're amused always because they're constantly being entertained themselves by the news of the part. But to stamp on night after night in My Fair Lady, I don't know how anybody ever does it.
I think you once thought of leaving acting and taking up direction.
I expect it'll give me up first, but I would like to be a director, and I don't think that you can be a director and an actor at the same time. I think the chores are too great, you know, and you must concentrate on the one thing. I would like to be a director, but I want to learn a little bit more about being an actor before I take on that responsibility.
You've been successful for a long time. Now, apart from talent, has luck played a part in it as well as talent?
Yes, I think luck plays a tremendous amount in everybody's life, but particularly in our life, in the movies. It's a sort of mixture of all the things, but it's being in the right place at the right time. Maybe even a sillier thing is meeting the right man at the right party. You know, he suddenly says, my God, you have just what I wanted, why didn't I think of you? Luck has a tremendous part of our job. I mean, you can plan it all ahead very carefully and say, I'll do this kind of picture and then that kind and vary the roles. But at the end of it all, you know, there's this awful element of luck which still comes in.
The Movies, broadcast on BBC Television, 17th of April, 1967.
What constitutes a film actor's day?
That's a very simple question. I suppose the simple answer is a great deal of work. basically, taking it step by step, it depends where you live, and I live in the country. By that I mean in Sussex, proper country, not Commuterville. And I'm sort of outside Tunbridge Wells, which means a long journey if I'm working at Twickenham or Shepparton. Sort of really 2 hours up and 2 hours back. I usually, on accident, which we made at Twickenham, I did 200 miles in the day, or 140 miles in the day. So that's quite a long way to go, and I have to get up at 5:30, 5:45 to get up, make tea, get into the car. I don't drive, because I don't drive. And generally sort of sit and be with the film. It's a very long day, because it's tiring, and you have to concentrate all the time.
No chance to relax during shooting?
None at all, not for me anyway. I find it impatient. It's only because I need more concentration than most people, because I'm rather stupid. One of the hardest things, hardest part I've ever had to play was the part I finished with Losey in Accident, which is a film of memory and mind. I won't get into that too much, but it's a desperately difficult thing because Harold is terribly hard to play anyway. I think I play him fairly well. I don't know, I hope so, pray I do. But it's what you don't say in Harold's work that is important, not what you say. And when I was finished on that, I was 2 weeks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.